In this video, we're going to discuss convolutional neural networks. And in this section, we're going to do little things a little differently. And we'll build our network, train it, and then in the next video, we'll analyze the results to try to better understand what's going on. So first, we'll go over the convolutional neural network constructor, discuss the forward step, and then we'll go over training. And just a note, we can apply many of the methods we learned in Chapter 5 and apply it to the convolution kernel, just like we applied it to the linear terms in our neural network. So here's a standard picture you might see for a convolutional neural network. And everything's pretty much the same as a regular neural network. We have the fully connected layer, but we have another set of parameters for the convolution kernels. And they're also obtained via training. So the training step is identical, and just our network architecture is different, and we have to include the convolution operations. So we're not going to get into the details of training, but it's pretty much identical to a fully connected network, and the math is just a little more complicated. So let's start off with a really simple example, and this is the simplest example I can come up with. And we're going to try to distinguish between a horizontal line and a vertical line. And the vertical line y will equal 0, and the horizontal line y will equal 1. And to make things interesting, we're going to add some noise. So for this iteration, the values might look like this. And for the next iteration, those little black points will be in different areas. So we'll take our input image, and let's just get rid of that to clarify everything. And we're going to build a very simple network. And for our first convolutional layer, we'll have two channels. And then we'll get our activation map. We'll have two activation maps. We'll apply an activation function and pooling. And we'll only have one output. So because we have two inputs, we'll require two kernels. And if you recall, for each input, we'll have our own kernel. We'll convolve the kernel with its corresponding input and add the results together. And we'll get something like that. And let's just clarify it in an independent step. So next thing we're going to do is apply an activation function and then max pooling. So let's put in our 3D diagram so we have a smaller output. And finally, we'll take this layer over here, and we're going to flatten it. And remember, this is just an activation value. And we're going to use this activation value as an input to a fully connected layer. So this has two hidden layers, but for our actual example, we'll only require an output layer. So here's the final diagram. So this is kind of hard to fit on one page. So let's do one more diagram to clarify everything. So we have the two channels corresponding to our first layer, and the second two channels corresponding to our second layer. And then we add the activation max pooling. So we take the two outputs from our first layer, convolve them together, then we'll apply activation function and pooling, and then connect it to our fully connected layer. Before we use it as an input to our fully connected layer, we're going to have to flatten it. So we'll take the output of this layer, which is just a set of activations, apply the activation function and pooling, flatten it, and then these will be the input to our fully connected layer. So just a note, to make things a little easier, for our network we only have two parameters, the output layer, the number of outputs for our first layer and the number of outputs for our second layer. So here's our object constructor, and we'll have one in channel because we're using grayscale. The parameter out, in this case, will be 2. And the kernel size and padding size, we will hard code them because they take a little more work to determine. So we'll add our redo activation and max pooling layer. And again, for max pooling and stride size, we'll have to take those into account when we calculate the size of our flattening layer. Then we'll construct our second convolutional layer. And you notice how the number of outputs for our first layer is equal to the number of inputs for a second layer. And our number of outputs for a second layer will be 1. Then we'll add a relu. Then we'll add a relu and max pooling layer. Finally, we'll create a linear layer. You notice how the number of inputs to this layer is equal to the number of outputs in the preceding layer. And just a note, these numbers over here are not easy to calculate. You have to take into account the size of the image after all these layers. So this line of code will assume we're going to flatten our image. And because we only have two classes, we'll have two outputs. So let's go over the forward step. And again, this is kind of big, so we're going to shrink this down a little. So let's add our second set of layers. So we'll perform activation and max pooling, convolve the two layers by activation and pooling again. Then we'll take that output, resize it, and then apply it to our final layer. And that'll be our output. So we'll have two outputs. We can create a training data set and validation set data set. And again, technically this is test set because we don't have any free parameters. And again, our only parameters for our model will be the number of outputs for our first layer and the number of outputs for our second layer. So everything else is pretty much the same as softmax or a regular neural network. Because it's multiple classes, we'll create a cross-entropy loss, create an optimizer, and our input will be the model. We'll create some lists to store our parameters. We'll create a train loader object and a validation loader object. And we'll perform training via gradient descent. And the only difference is we're not going to have to reshape our tensor because we're going to leave it as a rectangular image. And that's pretty much it. It's almost identical to softmax or a fully connected network.